And we've been announcing that there is an informational meeting, and that will take place today after the morning worship service in room 126. And so if you're interested in just hearing about the details or the cost or all that's involved in that, please make sure to attend that meeting after the service. Kids ministry, all kinds of stuff going on there. We've got VBS coming up, and so we want to continue to ask if you would like to serve in the upcoming VBS. River guides are wanted. And so come and embark on an epic cruise from Genesis to Revelation as SBC Kids presents Answers in Genesis, the Great Jungle Journey. And so there is a table out in the Welcome Center, and if you would like to investigate that or be a part of that, please go and sign up today. Also, this week, parents, very important, the SBC Kids are doing something a little bit different for Resurrection, and actually it involves this whole week. So after the service, when you go and pick up your kids, we want to encourage you parents to pick up what they call a Resurrection Week activity pack, one per family. And this has some different ideas and activities that you guys can do together this week as you celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And again, you can pick those up today at checkout. We are also promoting the CPC Walk for Life. You can help raise funds for the Crisis Pregnancy Center by doing the Walk for Life this year. There are three different walks that you could participate in. We do have some brochures on the back table. We also have a table set out in the Welcome Center. Kim Ellis will be manning that table. If you have questions or want to sign up, please stop by that table. Next Sunday is the Resurrection Sunday. Woo! We get to celebrate that Jesus is alive. Praise the Lord. So we're going to have a sunrise service, but it's going to be indoors, all right? 7 a.m., we'll put the sun on the screen, all right? But we're going to have a sunrise service here in the worship center at 7 a.m., followed by a breakfast, a church-wide breakfast. If you've not picked up your tickets, today is the last day to pick up your tickets, and so if you'll stop by in the Welcome Center and get those after the service today, because we've got to have a head count for next Sunday. Adults are $5, kids under three are free, but other children are simply $2. But I want to mention something to you that's a little different this year in the format. You've probably heard me talk about at 9:30, there's going to be a time of praise and worship here in the worship center. And basically the purpose of that is just an opportunity to praise the Lord together, to prepare our hearts for the morning worship time. And so if you finish breakfast early, you're welcome to hang out in fellowship, but if you'd like to enjoy some praise and worship, we want to invite you to come and be in here by 9:30 next Sunday morning, and we'll mention it again after the sunrise service. Also, one other thing that we're going to need help with on Resurrection Sunday is nurseries. I don't know if you knew this. A couple weeks ago, we had 30 babies. Okay, so if we don't get some help, I'm going to turn them loose on you guys in here. So we're going to need some help if you're CARE certified. No, trust me. I'll have them roll them right in here. No, I'm kidding. But we are going to need some help next Sunday because Resurrection Sunday is always a big Sunday. If you're CARE certified, would you please let Allison Carr or Alice Bass know that you would be available during the morning worship service. Also, a missions update this Wednesday night, March 27th, we're going to have Jen Goodrich. We support Bobby and Jen Goodrich at Rancho El Camino. She's going to be here Wednesday night to share an update during the evening service. Hope that you can make that. And then one last-minute addition. This year, we've been doing what is called the Navigators. We've been working with kids from Kilby Shores and just mentoring them, not only academically, but certainly wanting to invest truth in their life. Next year, we have an opportunity to be involved in the Good News Clubs at Kilby Shore. So we would like to maybe shift our focus from Navigators to Good News Clubs, but we're going to need some help. And so after the morning worship, there's a table out in the Welcome Center. Natalie Lundy is going to be at that table. This is a once-a-week commitment for 24 weeks. It'll be October through April. And it's a great way to be able to share the gospel with kids from our community on a weekly basis, and you'll be able to do that at the school. And over the years, through the Good News Clubs, lots of kids have come to know the Lord. And so if you're interested in what that looks like, what the responsibility would be, how we would carry that out, where is Natalie? Is she? She's out there? Okay, so she might be talking to somebody, but she is here. You can stop by that table in the Welcome Center right after the service, and you can ask any questions and prayerfully consider partnering with us for our Good News Clubs. All right. Hey, you know, today is Palm Sunday. You know, there was a significant event that happened on Palm Sunday. We'll get to that in a moment. Why don't you stand and let's enjoy some worship time together this morning.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met.
Day of our lives, right? Yeah, you gave your life to Christ. Whew. Thank you, Jesus.
I needed rescue. My sin was heavy. The chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. You called me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. And your love
that song. And I love Jesus, and I know you do too. Let's all recite this together. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things just, whatsoever things pure, whatsoever things lovely, whatsoever things of good report, if they be any virtue and if any praise, think on these things.
Amen. Amen. Good morning, Southside. It is so good to see you. We have a treat in just about 2 minutes. Our kids are going to be singing for us today, but we're going to have our time of fellowship, but then I'm going to come back and ask you to sit down so that we can get ready to hear how the kids have prepared a song for us today. So looking forward to that. But first, we'd like to welcome all of those who are visiting with us today. Thank you so much for coming and being a part of this worship service with us. Our ushers are going to make their way down the aisle, and if you would not mind, if you'd get their attention, we have a visitor card and a pen we'd like to put in your hand, and we'd like to ask if you would fill that information out, and you can drop that in one of the offering plates on your way out of the worship center today, and that'll give us an opportunity to be able to follow up with you. If you're visiting via live stream this morning, thank you so much for coming and being a part. Looking forward to our time together. If you'd like to connect with us, you can go to our church app or to our church website, and under the Connect tab is a little form. If you'll fill that out and send it in, we'll have an opportunity to follow up with you as well. All right, just a heads up, we're going to give you 60 seconds to chat, then I'm going to come back and hopefully get your attention. Go. We'll see how it works. Who knows? All right, folks, I hate to be the bearer of bad news. We're going to ask you to find your seat, if you would. We're looking forward to our kids. They're going to come and share some music with us this morning. So if we can find our seats. I know this is a terrible way to have to get you to settle down, right? I feel like I'm back in my principal days. All right, let's roll. Oh, yeah, All right. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Looking forward to hearing from our kids this morning.
Your
Let's give him another hand. Yeah. greatest worship songs. Sing from your heart. Give God all the praise.
The splendor of the King,
that's right,
clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God, sing with me, how great.
Sing it to him, come on.
How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. All will see how great is our God.
Yeah, praise the Lord, praise the Lord.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate y'all leading this morning, and certainly appreciated the kids coming in and singing. What a blessing that is. Good to see you folks here, and so glad you could be a part of our worship service today, as today is Palm Sunday, and what an incredible day we get to celebrate, and not just today, but certainly throughout the week as we consider all that our Savior goes through in this week. In fact, as we celebrate Palm Sunday, it's certainly a moment in history when, of course, Jesus, according to the Word, came riding into Jerusalem to begin, in my mind, what I think was one of the toughest weeks that would end with his death on the cross. and his death would not be in vain. I understand that in that day and time, maybe his death seemed confusing to some of the people in that day. But that was a death that would ultimately set free from bondage. Man, the bondage of sin, all those that believe. And Jesus' death accomplished so much more for you and I. And as we wrap up this morning, we're going to be looking, this is the last message in this series that we've been looking at spiritual warfare. And next Sunday, we're gonna look at a passage during the sunrise service that details, and I think it'll fit right in with what we've been studying. It details one very specific victory that Jesus provided for us through his life, through his death, and through his resurrection. It'll be the culminating of truth of really why, even in spiritual warfare, as the word says, we are more than conquerors through him. And so let's pray, and we're going to jump in. I've got a lot to try to cover with you this morning, a lot of connections that I hope to be able to make. I did make extra outlines in hopes that you would grab one, because I did put a lot of information, something that I hope you will take with you and that you will think through and make application to your life. But let's commit this time to the Lord this morning. Father, we are grateful for this opportunity, God, to gather. Thank you again for this place. Thank you for all of the folks, our praise team, God, our band, our sound, video, all of the workers, the ushers, our teachers, God, everyone who has been laboring this morning, just so that we could come together, enjoy some fellowship, enjoy the teaching of your word earlier in Sunday school and life group, and now, God, to come together in this moment as we continue just to seek to understand what the word teaches about spiritual warfare. So, God, some of the things we're going to talk about this morning may be difficult to hear, but I would pray that your spirit would just bring clarity. And, Lord, that if there's any defenses that exist where we would seek to resist the work of your spirit, God, I pray that you would even now begin to break those down. That, God, today you would find us ready and available and certainly willing to respond to the spirit of God's moving and to the word of God. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to be in several different passages this morning, so hopefully you have your Bible. I put a lot of the scripture on your outline, but I just thought it would be wise, especially if you're visiting with us, and maybe this is your first service with us, I just wanted to look back at some of the key points that we looked at last week together. One of the things I wanted to point out was some of the different authors or sources of where our thoughts come from, and we recognize that some of our thoughts come from ourselves. Remember Proverbs 23:7, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. And so, we also recognize, too, that our thought life can range from very fleshly to incredibly spiritual. But see, our thought life, how we reason and how we meditate or what we meditate upon, it's really a reflection of the influences in our life. And those influences can be good or they could be bad, but they are the things that we allow into our life. And so, as a believer, we find that it's necessary to train our minds to think on what God directs. And one of the ways that's good to do that is the scripture memory that we have been encouraging you folks to do. And I hope that's going well. I did get someone to come and share one of the verses with me Wednesday night. I praise the Lord for that. Don't hesitate to come and say, hey, let me share one of the verses that I've memorized. I would actually love to hear that. And of course, this morning, you saw again Philippians 4:8. That's the last verse that I gave you. Again, we're encouraged, we're directed to think on the things that are true and honest and just and pure and lovely and of a good report. God directs us in that. I shared with you Colossians 3:2 that we're to set our affections on the things above, not on the things of the earth. Those are the things that we're to be meditating on and thinking on. We also recognize that thoughts can come from the Spirit of God. We saw several different verses in the book of John where we recognize that the Spirit of God's ministry, he will teach us, he's going to lead us, and he's going to convict us. And so that could be an author of some of the thoughts that's going on. And then, of course, the last one is Satan, our enemy. And again, his great scheme, as it would relate among believers, is to try to influence or plant, if you would, intruding thoughts. The type of thoughts that would be tempting to our minds, or to encourage us to think thoughts that are not biblical, that are not right, that are not based in truth. And then, of course, in the temptation, if we give in to that temptation, he flips the switch and immediately becomes your accuser. And then we looked at what accusations can do, and we're going to see a passage of that this morning, but accusations can lead you to compare. And what happens in a person's life, if you don't confront it with the truth, those thoughts will end up wreaking havoc. And I think that's one of the takeaways as we did our identity study in Christ. Who we are in Christ. What does the word say about us as far as our position in Christ? And if we don't confront the things that have made it into our mind with the truth of God's word, it'll always impact you. And then we talked about Jesus as our advocate who represents us before our Father. And then we also talked about Jesus, the Word. And we find we are exhorted through the Word of God in our time in the truth. Now, let me go back and one other thing. See, when I say your position or your identity in Christ, it's where do you draw your worth and your value? People will call it self-esteem. And if you went through the identity class with me, then this is going to resonate as one of the things that we learned. So as a believer who is in Christ, according to the Word of God, you are deeply loved by God. You're completely forgiven, fully pleasing, and totally acceptable to and accepted by God. And as a new creation in Christ, you are complete in Him. And I'm telling you, there are a lot of believers who have never been taught those truths or what that means. And I'm telling you, there's a great peace that comes as you understand that. As we move today into the message today, I want to start with Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. And so if you want to flip there, you're welcome to just keep up with me in your Bibles this morning. This is a passage where it details Jesus leaving heaven and coming to earth. And in verse 5, something that Paul stated here, which really plays in to this thing we call spiritual warfare. In verse 5, he simply makes the statement, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." And you think, okay, how is it that I can have the mind of Christ? Well, if we look at this verse, and certainly in light of what we have already learned in our study, then we would conclude that since we are in Christ and He, by His Spirit, dwells in us, then the mind of Christ is in us because His Spirit is in us. And so when you look at this, "let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus," is actually about control. In other words, let this mind control you. Let this mind lead you. Let this mind educate you. Let this mind guard you. Let this mind encourage you. So the obvious question is that happening in your life? Is that the connection that you understand with the Spirit of God and the ministry of the Spirit of God in your life? Well, when you study spiritual warfare, one of the things that you'll come away with is a greater awareness of this battle. And sometimes when you're studying this, the battle increases. In fact, just being transparent, I was really having a battle right there just a few moments ago while you guys were singing, and I was asking the Lord for help. Because in my mind, there was a thought that came that should not be there. It should not be there when you approach the Word of God. And I knew that. And I knew that that had to be resolved in that moment, or this was going to be delayed. And by God's grace, we sang long enough, thank you, Lord, that was addressed. But you understand, this thing is real. This is a real battle, and I think one of Satan's tactics includes trying to convince you that when you're in a battle like that, that you're the only one who thinks that way. In fact, you're the only one who struggles like that, and I just want to tell you, that's a lie. That's why I have you learning 1 Corinthians 10:13, because it just simply says, there's no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. And so you see, truth dispels a lie. But when you look at the Bible, you recognize that there are lots of people who got caught. Who got caught? Eve, battling pride, I think, in the garden. You look at Noah, a little bit of maybe fear, and his battle with fear and faith in building this ark. I look at Abraham, he battled fear at least twice as it relates to famine. You look at David, who battled lust. Jesus, in the Garden of Gethsemane, what a battle that took place there in the garden. Look at Demas, who battled the draw of the world. And of course, Paul, he battled his personal desires. So every believer deals with this. I don't care who you are. I don't care how long you've been saved. I don't care how old you are, how young you are, every believer deals with this battle, and every believer is going to experience a point where you're tired, where you're weary, and there's something that's going on, and you think it's hopeless. I'm never going to overcome this thought. I'm never going to be rid of this. And the idea is the enemy wants to bring you to a place where there's no hope, and so we stop trying. In other words, this is where people give up. And I think God knew this battle would impact us. And I believe that he wrote about it extensively in his word. And we have a secure position in him. And we have his spirit within us that's leading us. And he's enabling us. And we have his word, which is an incredible weapon for this warfare that we are engaged in. Imagine trying to live the Christian life today without the word of God. Now, what ends up happening in this, and what you need to see it for what it is that God is at work in and through you to develop this mind of Christ in you. And at times, God's going to use various people. He's going to use different circumstances to do this. In fact, if you think about it right now, depending on where you're at mentally and what's going on, I just like to encourage you, that's what he's doing, even now. If he wasn't, why else would there be such a struggle taking place in your life? Remember, it's the spirit versus the flesh. And so this battle, you need to see it for what it is. He's developing in you him. And so fighting this good fight of faith for your mind, I want you to recognize that there's some things that you have got to deal with. All right? If you're going to fight for the control of your mind, you're going to need to deal with some things. Here's the first one. You're going to have to deal with thoughts of the past. I cannot even begin to tell you, over the years of ministry, the stories and the things that I've heard that exist in people's pasts that are still in control of them. Because it's the question of why. Why did that happen? Why did I do this? Why did this work out this way? And sometimes in the past, there exists unforgiveness. Maybe there's past glories in your past, and it's not happening today. Maybe there's missed opportunities. Maybe there's a carrying of guilt. But I'd just like to ask you a question about your past, if you would just hear me out here. What has been so interesting to me as a pastor listening to this is how much time and control something we cannot change can continue to change us into something that we don't want to be. Let me ask that again. How is it that how much time and control something that we cannot change can continue to change us into something we do not want to be? Now, when you're talking about thoughts of the past, here's the strategy, as I think, from the enemy. The idea is to numb you with the goal to defeat you and to paralyze you. And what happens is, through that, if you're giving in to that, you're going to be in a fog about who you are in Christ or the freedom that Christ provides. If you look at Paul's life as a past religious fanatic and murderer, that could have paralyzed him. But what did he say? He chose to forget what was behind and to press towards the mark, forward in his life. So if you remember that sometimes the past can paralyze you, it can paralyze you with guilt. And I would say, you need to understand, you need to realign your understanding and your faith to believe that it's simply through the blood of Christ that God can free you and cleanse you of all sin. And the reality is, every person in this room probably is aware of someone who is presently paralyzed by their past. The question I would ask you, though, is it possible that that person is actually you? And you just won't admit that. See, here's a principle for your past. Things left unresolved never go away. And if you don't deal with your past, it will forever hinder your future. God's greater than your past. How about thoughts of the present? This is the question of how. And we know things get out of control. How did that happen? And when things get out of control, we start to worry, whether that's financial pressure, maybe things are piling up, bills are piling up, maybe job security, okay? And we start to worry. Maybe it's fear from current events, or maybe some things, some decisions that you have made that turned out wrong, and it's just kind of rocked your world, and it's maybe rocked your thinking. It might be that tragedy has struck, and it's just left you feeling empty or lost or alone. Maybe relationships are just going south. And one of the things that I have learned about relationships, especially in husband-wife relationships, when they're going south, the mind starts to wander. And you begin to get into things that you would have not done before, but you rationalize it away because of all the frustration you're going through. And I would say again, if fear and worry consume your thoughts in the present, then what ends up happening, what I would say is that that's how indifference can settle in, and you'll see that beginning to impact your decisions. Making decisions from an apathetic or an indifferent heart is not a good place. Why is that? Think of it this way. Situations and circumstances, they don't make you what you are. They reveal what you are. And so God is trying to open your eyes and get your attention in that. And so when it comes to this principle of the present, man, if you are paralyzed, if you are overcome with worry and fear, listen, you can't control what comes at you. You can't control what happens. But the reality is, you do get to choose how you will respond. And that's important. And then thoughts of the future. This is the question of what. What is going to happen? what's going to be the outcome of this? Or what's going to take place here? Or what's going to happen when this happens to us? Or, you know, we get into these questions of what. And sometimes it's about eternity. Or sometimes it's about family. Or sometimes it's about life. Maybe life has taken a very drastic turn. Maybe there's retirement in your future and you're not ready for that. Or maybe kids. Or can I go ahead and say what I'm thinking? You know, okay. So here's one for us. What? We're going to be grandparents. So I'm learning how to pray for a grandkid I haven't met yet. And we're excited. We're excited about that. Excited and already praying. We don't know if it's a boy or a girl, but praying for their salvation already. So looking forward to that. But see, those are the questions about what's ahead of us. Listen, if fear and worry consume your thoughts of the future, then I would just simply say, believer, you're not walking by faith, you're walking by sight. And that might be hard to hear, but that would be the truth. And the principle of the future that I would give you is this. Our greatest hope and comfort is found in who we are and what we have in Christ. And as we understand that, we need to learn to rest in Him. So when you think about these three areas, there are three questions. All right. So has God answered, solved, and provided everything that a believer needs in order to deal with their past? And I would say yes, God has provided forgiveness. Has God answered, solved, and provided everything a believer needs in order to deal, to live in the present? And I would say yes, it is a faith that's based in the truth of God's word. And has God answered, solved, and provided everything that a believer needs in order to look forward to the future? And I would say yes, because we have a sure hope in Jesus. And so this battle for the mind, I want to look at this as it relates to waging this battle and winning this battle, but through Jesus. Now, here's something that I always thought was interesting that Paul brought out in Romans chapter 7, verse 21. You don't have to turn there. I'd actually ask you to go to 2 Corinthians chapter 10, if you would. But when Paul was in this mental battle, if you would, in Romans chapter 7, he made the most unusual statement in verse 21. He said this. He said, when I would do good, evil is present with me. You ever felt that way? Man, I'm like, are you kidding me? But that's, again, that's this war. Guys, you're not going to be away from all of this influence and darkness and all that kind of stuff until you see Jesus. So you might as well just strap in and get ready, because we are engaged in a battle. And I'm telling you, if you didn't know that before, you'll start to see it, that when you do good, evil is present with you. But 2 Corinthians chapter 10, I thought this was interesting, that Paul draws out from accusations a spiritual battle truth. So let me read verses 1 through 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 1 through 5. Now, I, Paul, myself, beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, who in presence am base among you, but being absent am bold toward you. But I beseech you that I may not be bold when I am present with that confidence, wherewith I think, to be bold against some, which think of us as if we walked according to the flesh. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, and having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. So what's interesting here, just a little bit of the background. You see in this chapter that Paul is under attack. And by the way, he's under attack for doing good. Have you ever been there? He's under attack for doing good. In fact, accusations by the enemy, even in this, it could lead and could have led Paul, tempted Paul's mind to be persuaded to think differently than what Christ had already established in his mind. And see, that's a part of the strategy here. The strategy of the enemy is to somehow undercut the truth that you have accepted by a suggestion that he can make, such as this. Here's one. You know what? You can say, you're really not a believer. Or, you know what? You need to handle this. Don't wait on the Lord. You've got this. You can do this. Or, you know what? You can't go any further. You've reached your point. Or, you know what? You can't get involved in that because you don't know enough. You can't witness to people. You don't know enough. The idea is to create doubt, right? And in creating doubt, that can prevent you or, again, paralyze you. And for some, it stunts their growth. They're not growing in him. But the mystery is, it's actually through those moments. In other words, if you're in the fire right now, you can honestly say, praise the Lord. I know that sounds weird. Because it's in the fire where actually we come to understand that he is real and that his word is true. For example, look back at the passage. In verse 2, I think they're accusing him of his ministry being a selfish ministry. In other words, he's only in it for himself. In verse 7, I think they call him, he's not really a Christian. In verse 10, it really gets ugly. They say he has no personality. They call him ugly, poor communicator, that his letters might be strong, but he's weak. And you know what the concluding suggested doubt is there? Hey, listen, God would never choose anyone like that. And see, you look at these accusations, and don't think for a moment they don't impact people. They do. They affect us. And sometimes we tend to believe it, or at least accept them. And we begin to wonder. Remember, when you're accused of something, a lot of times you start playing this comparison game. And if you don't confront it with truth, it's going to change you. In other words, let me say it this way. When sometimes those things have come out, I've seen people quit ministry over less. I've seen them stop teaching over less. I've even seen people leave the church over less. And that's because in this battle for the mind, it's interesting, the enemy is given a place to work, and he keeps feeding it. He keeps feeding that ground until ultimately the wrong thinking leads to wrong decisions. And so you see Paul change the tone of his message here, and he begins to answer these unkind things. Now, just remember the principle. As a person thinks in their heart, so are they, right? So this is an important battle here. And so look at verse 3. He says, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. That's key. Listen, this is where we live, move, and breathe for now. But as believers, this is not our home. This is not our home. And more importantly, this is not who we are. In other words, the world, this is not who we are. We are a new creation in Christ. And when that moment came in your life, when that change took place, God spiritually moved you out of the realm of darkness and into the light. Now, we still live on this earth where darkness seems to be prevalent, but our lives are now lived or to be lived with eternity in mind. And so we need to change our strategy or need to change our perception. In other words, we are not civilians who are living in peace. We are actually soldiers who are engaged in a war. It's interesting. Arthur Matthews made this statement. He said, as believers, we are in Christ and he is in us. And this means that his aggression against Satan must be expressed through us. So we are no longer free to play the role of civilians living as if there is no war. And if you think about it, the history of the saints in every age was really one of conflict. And the path that a disciple walks when he follows after the Lord, it's going to have trials, tribulation, and challenges. And so as a soldier, think about it. D.M. McIntyre said this. He said, the first duty of a soldier is obedience. The most evident duty of a soldier is to endure hardness, and the ultimate duty of a soldier is to offer the supreme sacrifice. Is that how you live your faith? See, our war, our fighting, is not a physical fight. It's a spiritual fight. And so if we accept the fact that our role in life is like that of a soldier, then we have to drop our toys. And we've got to become more acquainted with the weapons of our warfare. So in a real war situation, one of the soldier's best friends is his weapon. Why is that? Because it is one of the resources for disposing of the enemy, securing his safety, but also in obeying his leader, whoever his captain or whoever that is. And so when we are at war in a physical, or if we are warring physically, we're not fighting spiritually. Now look at verse 4. He says, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, they're not physical, they're not fleshly. He says, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of a stronghold. And I just wanted to remind you, you do realize that Jesus won, right? He did win, right? Yeah, they killed him, okay. But on the third day he rose. And there are a lot of things that the Bible helps us understand that Jesus did. Colossians 2:15, just one quick verse. And I'm reading this in the Amplified because I think it helps to illustrate it. He says, but God disarmed the principalities and the powers that were ranged against us. Who is the us? Really, it could be for everyone. They would just simply need to repent and believe. But in context here, us. And he said, he made a bold display and a public example of them. Notice this, in triumphing over them in him and in it the cross. That's a fabulous passage there in Colossians chapter 2. Now listen, there are a lot of physical weapons that you could think of. You may own a bunch of them. In this area, wouldn't be surprised. I've seen gun safes seemingly the size of a shed, but I mean, praise the Lord, I'm not against that. I think that's great. But I just like to remind you, there's not one weapon, physical weapon, that any of you own that is powerful enough to pull down a spiritual stronghold. There's no weapon you could fire physically that can deal with doubt or fear or hurt or anger or bitterness or resentment, the issues of worth and value, abilities, addiction, unforgiveness, greed, lust. You can fire all day long. You can't stop that. And holding on to those things, letting those things rule your life, letting those things control is really, in my opinion, evidence that you have surrendered ground in your life. And there is an absence of not only applying spiritual truth in your life, but understanding the weapons that God has given. There are spiritual weapons that are available, but I just got to tell you, they're useless unless you fire them. We have the Word of God, we have the Spirit of God, and as you're going to see, prayer. So flip over to Ephesians chapter 6. I want to give you just a little bit of a overview of the armor here. I don't have time to get into the whole thing, but if you look at verse 13, I'm going to read something that God gave me a few years ago, and I just want you to key on the actual word, if you would. So in verse 13, I want you to notice verses 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, and the first part of 18. If you write in your Bible, underline the word that I give you. We're going to look at truth, righteousness, gospel, faith, salvation, sword, and prayer. All right, those are the key terms in each of those verses. Truth, righteousness, gospel, faith, salvation, sword, and prayer. All right, now with that in your mind, please listen. It says that we are to stand therefore having your loins girt about with truth. Hold to the truth as the central focus in your life. the breastplate of righteousness. Stand in the righteousness that is yours in Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:21. You have been made the righteousness of God in Christ. Integrity, morality, right standing before God. You have a position you could have never earned, but has been given you by grace and mercy. Walk in the gospel, which is your peace with God, but it is your threat to the enemy. Walk prepared and ready. Know what you believe, why you believe, and hold to that belief so that faith, which acts as a shield, that's the covering for your life. And let everything that salvation gives you protect your head, your mind, so that you're able to fight knowing what is truth and what is a lie. And your sword, which is the word of God, those are the verses that you're memorizing. You're hiding God's word in your heart, and prayer. See, prayer is often left out. But I would like to submit to you that you know what prayer is? That's your guard duty. If you're going to follow this imagery, that's your guard duty. It's your guard duty for your life, but also your guard duty for the lives of others. When you see the enemy coming, whether it's against you or against those around you, sound the alarm in prayer before the Lord. Do you know who provided all that? It's called the armor of God because God is the one who provided that. God is the one who gave us truth. God is the one who made you righteous. God is the one who gave us the gospel. God is the one who is worthy to trust in and believe. God has provided salvation. God has given you his word. And God has given you access. Man, must be exactly what we need, right? But do you know what it's for? Go back to verse 4 of 2 Corinthians 10. He says, to the pulling down of strongholds. You see, the danger seems to lie in this building or in this establishing of a stronghold because according to the word, it takes a spiritual weapon to tear it down. So what is a stronghold? Well, specifically speaking, this word speaks like of a castle or of a strong fortress. But I want to give you a figurative picture because I think this is how it relates spiritually. Figuratively, it means anything on which one relies upon. So in all honesty, that means you're either relying in your life on truth or you're relying in your life on a lie because this is how it works. So when the enemy attacks with his arguments and his reasonings, what he's endeavoring to do is to create that doubt and to begin to fortify the opinion that he's trying to present to you and then defend it against you. So you look at it this way. He seeks to influence your thoughts with lies through arguments and reasonings whereby he can fortify his place, I would call that ground in your life, and keep feeding that to solidify his ground of influence in your life. And see, that's accomplished when we're not guarding well our minds and our hearts. And so he presents the arguments, he presents the reasonings, he presents ultimately those accusations by which he endeavors to fortify in his opinion against you. But here are the areas. Let me just give you a few of how this works. So the strongholds are confronting your belief system. So you think about the things that as a believer you believe in. For example, morality. Is marriage really between a man and a woman? How many genders are there? Is marriage a contract or is it a covenant? Do you see? And I would say just in that right there, those three things, there's great disparity among believers in our country, even though we all would say we have the same Bible. That's what he does. That's what he does. That's why doctrine is important here. That's why we establish what we believe and we endeavor to stand to that and hold to that. It's our standard. How about this? Values. Do you tell the truth? You ever told a white lie? You ever reasoned away not telling the truth? Or how about honesty? Are you an honest person? How about your character, your integrity? See, what's interesting is a lot of times that doesn't get confronted. It's only when it's going to cost you that the enemy says, hey, listen, you know, nobody's going to know about this one. You're good. Or about truth. What is truth? I happen to believe that the Bible is truth. And the Bible gives us absolute truth, but that's not the world we live in today. It's not the world we live in today. Or hard times. Circumstances have come, you don't like them. There's been some loss or hurts or suffering. You see, I told you. They tell you at church God loves you, but see, if God really loved you, you heard that before, right? Or how about obedience? Who is it you're going to follow? You're going to follow the Spirit of God? Or are you going to follow after your flesh or family? What is a family? Boy, there's confusion there today. I think sometimes the kids are leading the family today. How do you raise a family? How do you make tough decisions? Or how do you discipline? How do you resolve conflict? How do you educate them? What's the priority of our family when it comes to the church? What is church? Why do you go to church? Where does the church stand in your order? Do you see all of this stuff, man? All of this stuff coming at you 24/7. And what he does is he knows the flesh. And he knows how busy you are. And he knows how exhausted you can get. And he knows how to fire that. What about your workplace? What kind of a worker are you? Are you fair, truthful, honest, hard worker, courteous? Or do you know how to get around things? See, why do I say all of that? See, as a believer, we're supposed to be salt and light, and we're to be a testimony. And see, why I'm giving this to you is because your belief system is who you really are. And who you are flows from what you believe. And what you believe is either authored by God or the enemy. And so the ground of your mind, it's critical, church. If Satan gets a place and he begins to erect the stronghold, what he's talking about in Scripture, that which you will rely on, he'll use his arguments and his reasonings, and he's going to seek to fortify his place, his position, his opinion, and he's going to defend that against you. And that brings us to verse 5, and this will be the action step, if you would. I appreciate your patience. It was just a lot to try to get through, but I could not figure out a place to break this up. So this battle plan for your mind is really 4 steps in my mind, and I do this every day. Every day of my life. I can't even tell you how many times I do this every day. I was doing it right over there before the service. I really believe what God brings out here and what Paul wrote in verse 5. Now, here's what I want to do. I want to read verse 5 to you, but I'm going to define some words for you. The word casting there means that you're going to refute that, or you're going to destroy it, or you're going to demolish it. What is that you're going to do? You're going to cast down, you're going to demolish imaginations. Now, what is an imagination here? I look at this as anything that is hostile to my Christian faith. That's what the imagination is referring to. So anything that's hostile to my Christian faith, and here it is, every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of Christ. In other words, is there anything in your life that gets a greater priority than growing to know and walk with the Lord? Oh my goodness, that hurts, right? Because we all do, right? There are things that get more of our time and attention, right? That's what he's talking about here. See, we're out of balance here. You can't say, seek first the kingdom of God if this is the way you're at. You can't say that. And so the hard thing is to put off. Yeah, this is hard. But that's what he's talking about there. See, it's because you're here that you're encountering some of the warfare and problems and trials that you are because you're out of balance. And he says to casting down imaginations and every high thought, you're to demolish every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. And you're to bring into captivity. In other words, the picture is to lead it away captive, to bring it under control. What is that? Every thought. Whew. That's a lot of work. I'm going to tell you what, if you practice this, you ain't got time, half the time, to think about anything else. Because he's talking about every thought. Any thought that seeks to draw you away from God, mental perception, something that's evil, something, we've all had that moment where we're like, oh my stars, where did that come from? You take that thought captive, and you're going to cast it down. The idea continues. You're going to cast it down in obedience to Christ. So let me give you the 4 key words here and what I do and what I encourage you to do. The key words are cast, capture, investigate, and sentence. All right? Cast, capture, investigate, and sentence, and then I promise you I'll be done. So we're to cast down any thought, any idea, any dream, any plan, anything that is hostile to your faith. In other words, to what you believe. Or something that suggests a higher priority or place in your life than the Lord in knowing and walking with him. Now, don't raise your hand, but I wonder if there are not some folks who God has identified what has been more of a priority in your life than Him. That's a tough moment. But I want you to understand, this is a regular action with thoughts in your life. And so you've got to cast them down. So what happens is, second, you've got to capture that. Sometimes those thoughts are going to come. And sometimes the thoughts are very easy. Yes, I absolutely, positively know that's not of the Lord. Boom, cast it down. But sometimes there are thoughts that come into your mind and you're not sure. You're still growing. You're not sure what the word says, and so you capture. In other words, you're not going to allow that thought to have any influence in your life until you investigate that thought, which means you might need to ask questions. You might need to do some research in the word. You might need to seek wise counsel. But until you figure out the truth, you have rendered that thought, it's immobilized. It's not going to have any opportunity in your life. And so in your investigation, okay, when you begin to investigate, here's what you're going to learn. You're going to learn something about your faith. You're going to learn something about the value of your faith. Because if you're here, okay, just being honest, if you're here out of balance, but today you make a change, you know what I would say to that person? That's someone who values their faith. But if you're just trying to get through the moment and leave like this, you couldn't convince me that you value your faith. And so when you investigate and you begin to see what Christ has done, you begin to see what God has written in His Word, and you begin to value your faith and the power, God reveals to you the power of your faith. Man, then the last one, sentence it. You see, that's where you're going to be the judge. You're going to be the one who decides based on the evidence, either this is from the world or this is from the Word. You're the one who decides whether it remains. Now listen, what happens is as you grow in this, there are just immediate things you know to throw down. You just, done with that one. But the things that you investigate, see later on you'll remember, oh yeah, I already looked at that. Nope. And so you begin to grow. And you know what begins to happen as you begin to walk this way and you taking thoughts captive and you cast them down and you're growing in your faith? All of a sudden you realize that, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. You're allowing the mind of Christ, led by the Spirit of God in you, to control you, to lead you, to teach you, to encourage you, and to enable you. And so as we leave here today, I got three things for you on your takeaway. Simply this, what has the Lord revealed to you today about your thought life? You don't have to struggle with your past. God's blood is sufficient to cover. And you don't have to worry about the present. No, you can walk by faith and not by sight, as unto the Spirit of God. And you don't have to worry about the future. If you're in Christ, you're good. You have a sure hope in Jesus. And so God has provided victory. He has provided a way. He has provided help for your thought life. But it's going to come back to what will you decide. My second question is, how familiar are you with the spiritual weapons that God has provided? Because if you're losing the battle for your mind, then maybe it might be wise to spend some time looking at the Word of God. And I'm going to tell you, memorization is going to be one of the places you land. You're going to have to memorize the Word of God if you want to be successful in this war. And then the last one is, if you're willing to begin to apply God's Word, if you're willing to adopt and begin to walk through casting down, and when you come across thoughts that you need to investigate, you're going to capture that, you'll investigate it, and then you will render a decision based upon what you learn and how God works in and through your life. I'm telling you, this is my life. This is my life. I am constantly exercising this in my life because I don't know about you, but my mind can be a garbage can at times, and I hate it. I absolutely hate it, and I get angry because I don't want those thoughts to control me. And so I apply God's word, and by God's grace, a lot of the times when I do this, I can't even remember what it was, and I praise God for that because I don't want to. Now listen, if you're not a believer, if you have never repented of your sin and confessed faith in Christ, I just want you to know, in this battle for your mind, you're on your own. You have nothing to draw from. And if the Spirit of God is so convicted in that, I would implore you to respond in the invitation today and allow one of us to share the gospel with you today. As a believer, if this is you today, my prayer is that before you leave, you'll make things right with the Lord and begin to walk in the freedom and in a newness of life. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this opportunity. God, I appreciate their patience. I have gone over a little bit today, but God, I did not see where I could divide this up, and I just trusting that by your Spirit's leading and the folks that you have gathered today in this room and online, God, there was a great purpose in all of this, and I am praying that, God, you would bring forth the fruit that, Lord, you wrote this for. God, that you would bring forth the fruit in our lives that you desire of. God, I just can't imagine, Lord, when we continue to struggle because of our laziness or whatever that would be, I know that it grieves your heart. And so, God, today, I pray that you would clearly bear witness, God, in how you're desiring to lead and what you're desiring to do in this time of invitation. Lord, as pastors, give us wisdom. Whether we pray or counsel, God, we ask that you would give us wisdom, Lord, to encourage and to direct should anyone respond today. God, we praise you and thank you for all that you have done. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, would you stand as we worship together?
Walk the road.
patience and extreme was strong enough to come and fight for me, to go through hell and down into the grave and raise me up to see you face to face. You raise me up to see you face.
Okay, so last week we prayed over a team that headed to West Africa. They're there now. They're doing really well. In fact, the weather's been really good there for them, not as hot as normal, but they're getting some work done there. Today we have a small team leaving to going down to North Carolina to do some rebuild. So I'd ask if Ron and your team could come forward, and we're going to pray over you today. We have both foreign missions as well as local missions. Ron Early here leads our Southern Baptist Disaster Relief Team that goes all over wherever they're called to do any kind of disaster relief, rebuilding, hurricane repairs, all those kind of things, and the team is very dedicated to that. So we're going to pray over them today before they go. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for today's message and how it speaks to our heart, Father God. And as we go through life, Lord, we know there's spiritual warfare that we will encounter, because the closer we draw to you, the closer the enemy draws to us. And so, Lord, you've given us the weapons to fight with, Lord, and that is your word. Father, today we do lift up the disaster relief team as they're going out, Lord, to help people that need assistance. And, Father God, we just ask it as they go, not only will they be doing physical work, but they'll be doing your work, Lord, by carrying the gospel to people that are in need and people that need Jesus. So, Lord, we just ask you to go with them, protect them, give them safety, and bring them back to us, Lord, healthy. We love you, Lord. Ask us as we go this week out into the world that we do go out as a salt and light, Lord, transparent to this world, that the Lord would see you and not us. For it is in Christ's name we pray. Amen.